Please rise in your body and spirit and join with me in our call to worship. Come, listen to the word of the Lord.
May we receive God's direction for our lives.
Come, proclaim the goodness of God's love.
May our voices and our actions be filled with love.
Come, now is the time to worship.
May our worship be acceptable to the Lord our God.
Please remain standing as the Gathering Center opens hymn, America the Beautiful, which is number 799.
Forgive us our lack of faith and vision.
Please join with me in offering a prayer of illumination printed in your bulletin. Shall we pray?
Holy God, in the midst of the multitude of words we hear in our daily lives, speak your eternal truth to us, that we may respond to your gracious promise with faithfulness, mission, service, and love. Amen.
Our Old Testament reading comes from Psalm 48, verses 9 through 14. This reading can be found on pages 490 and 491 in the Pew Bible. Listen now to the reading of the Holy Scripture. We have thought on thy steadfast love, O God, in the midst of thy temple. It's thy name, O God, so they pray, thy praises reaches to the ends of the earth. The right hand is filled with victory. Let Mount Zion be glad. Let the daughters of Judah rejoice because of thy judgments. Walk around Zion. Go round about her. Number her towers. Consider well her ramparts. Go through her citadels, that you may tell the next generation that this is God. Our God forever and ever. He will be our guide forever. Our gospel reading this morning is from the 6th chapter of Mark, verses 1 through 13, and can be found on page 872 of your Pew Bible. He went away from there and came to his own country, and his disciples followed him. And on the Sabbath he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astonished, saying, "Where did this man get all this? What is the wisdom given to him? What mighty works are wrought by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, brother of James and Joseph, and Judas and Simon, and not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. And Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honor, except in his own country, and among his own kin, and in his own house. And he could do no mighty work there, except that he laid his hands upon a few sick people and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief. And he went among the villagers teaching. And he called to him the 12 and began to send them out 2 by 2 and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He charged them to take nothing for the journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not put on 2 tunics. And he said to them, "Where you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. And if any place will not receive you, and they refuse to hear you, when you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet for a testimony against them." So they went out and preached that men should repent, and they cast out many demons, and anointed with oil many that were sick and healed them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, I was saying one verse of "Jesus Loves Me," and you come forward with a special message today.
Make it rain, and I've been praying for rain, I probably should carry my umbrella, because the carpenter? Can he do miracles? Can he do those things? So their faith, their lack of faith, actually limited the power that God had through Jesus. Jesus couldn't do many miracles because those people in the town of Nazareth didn't have faith that God could do anything. So just remember that when you pray for things, you have to show God that you actually believe that he can do what you're praying for. So if you're going to pray for rain and you're going to leave your house, don't forget your umbrella, okay? Let's say a prayer.
Some of you may have remembered that I mentioned that I had some guests at my house. It actually was my sister-in-law and my brother-in-law and my other sister-in-law were visiting at our house. The siblings like to get together once a year and have that opportunity to visit, and they were at our house just a couple of weeks ago. And one of the topics that came up for discussion at that time was the oldest sibling in the family, which is not Anne, by the way, the oldest sibling in the family, Cindy, her 50th high school reunion is coming up this next month, right? August? Yeah, in August. 50th high school reunion. So she was talking about that and talking about she's going to go with a friend of hers back to Papa Bluff. They grew up in Papa Bluff, went to high school there. And so she's going to her 50th high school reunion. Of course, that makes you think of reunions if you've ever gone to high school reunions. You know, think about your own reunion. Someday, Jacob, you may go to a high school reunion.
He's got to graduate.
Oh, yeah, graduate. Then who knows? It's still up in the air as to whether that'll happen for you or not. But I've gone to different high school reunions. I know some of you have gone to various types of reunions. And it's always sort of an interesting thing to think about and to consider, particularly if you no longer live in your hometown. I know some of you do. Some of you were born and raised here in St. Genevieve, so it's a little different situation for you perhaps. But for most of us who no longer live in our hometowns, and we think about going back to our hometown for some kind of reunion to get together with people that we knew long ago, lots of different types of thinking that go into that. You know, you're thinking, are they even going to recognize me anymore? Will I recognize any of them any longer? You know, what will they think of me? You know, and what situations are they in today? What kind of situation am I in? And of course, our memories of them are the memories when we lived there, when it was our hometown. And so that's the context in which we knew them, of course. And so there's always a little bit almost of trepidation about going to a reunion of sorts if you haven't been back for a while. And of course, the story that we heard from Mark this morning was the very first time that Jesus returns to his hometown after he had begun his ministry of teaching and preaching and healing, his ministry of spreading the good news of God across the countryside. And he had made quite a name for himself at this particular time. And he returned to his hometown of Nazareth, the town in which he had lived until he was 30 years old. Not just going through his teenage years there. He was actually a man in Nazareth and worked there as a carpenter. We don't know a whole lot about Jesus' life before his ministry began, but we are told that he lived in this town of Nazareth. And it is believed that he worked in his father's carpentry shop and took up that trade. So he was a carpenter there in Nazareth, and worked there until he was 30 years old. So he had been there for several years. He'd only been away for a year, year and a half, and he returned as someone that had made quite a name for himself in traveling around Galilee, traveling around this whole region. And the people in his hometown reacted sort of negatively toward Jesus. They couldn't believe, wait a minute, this is Jesus. You know, we know Jesus. We've been around Jesus all of his life and a big part of our life. What does he mean by coming here and preaching all of this newfangled stuff? Why are there these crowds around him? You know, this guy, he's just the carpenter. He's Mary and Joseph's son. We know him. You know, what's the big deal? What's going on here? They certainly treated him according to all of the gospel passages that talk about Jesus' return to Nazareth. They certainly treated him with contempt. They couldn't believe, you know, that he was anything special, because they were very familiar with Jesus. And we heard that reflected in our passage this morning. And I think that in itself is quite a message for us, for we in the church, Christians as we call ourselves. Hey, guess what? We've known Jesus all of our lives. We've grown up with Jesus. We're very familiar with Jesus. We've all heard all the stories about Jesus. So there's certainly a danger for us as well, church people, Christians today in the 21st century, to become too familiar with Jesus so that we treat Jesus with contempt ourselves. That's the beginning for what we're thinking about this morning in this message that I call contempt for the familiar. Shall we pray? Gracious God, may the words of my lips and the meditations of our hearts and minds be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Now, our gospel lesson this morning actually consists of two parts, if you were paying attention when Ed was reading or following along in your pew Bible. The first part of the passage from Mark does talk about Jesus' return to his hometown, Nazareth. And as a matter of fact, Jesus was known as he traveled around the Galilee countryside. Jesus was known as Jesus of Nazareth because people were automatically associated with their hometowns at this particular time in history. And if you remember, can anybody tell me what Jesus' last name was? Some people would say, of Nazareth. He didn't have a last name as far as we know. Most people did not, were not given last names at this particular time in history. So one of the ways that they identified you was identifying you by name and the town that you were from. Thus he would call, it was called Jesus of Nazareth. It would cause you to ask, well, how many people named Jesus lived in Nazareth? Probably not very many, were there? It was a small town. And that name was not that common a name. At this particular time in history, it was not an uncommon name, but it was not that common a name. So this was Jesus of Nazareth. The second part of Mark's reading talks about Jesus, after he's been shunned in his own hometown, he sends his disciples out two by two for the very first time, out on mission by themselves, without him, to some of the surrounding areas. And their missions are very successful. They are very well received in the area around him. So there's sort of a contrasting two stories here. Jesus not being well received in his hometown, and the disciples going out for the very first time, two by two, into the countryside, and their message being very well received, and the fact that then that they are able to perform all kinds of miracles themselves among the peoples, which Jesus was not able to do in his own hometown. Aside from healing a few sick people, which seems pretty miraculous to me. But anyway, he wasn't in his full glory, certainly, when he returned to Nazareth. I believe that visiting Nazareth must have been a very compelling moment in Jesus' life. Just as returning to your 50th high school reunion would be sort of a milestone in your life. Oh, I know somebody that did that just not very long ago. Yeah, Richard here in town. It was your 50th just a year or two ago, wasn't it? Yeah, sort of a milestone marker in your life. And I think this Jesus returning to the for the first time to Nazareth had to be a very compelling moment for him. And I believe it was Thomas Wolfe who famously claimed, "You cannot go home again. You cannot go home again." I think after reading this passage, Jesus would agree with Thomas Wolfe's statement. Up until this point in his ministry, Jesus had been dramatically successful in what he was doing and in what he was trying to accomplish. Last Sunday, we heard about the woman that just came up and touched the very hem of his robe, and she was healed. And then the rest of that story goes on. Jesus goes to Jairus' daughter, who has actually already died by the time Jesus gets there, and he brings her back to life. I mean, those are the stories that are preceding this story where Jesus is being tremendously successful in his ministry and in his healing and in his teaching, and he goes to Nazareth, and he is not successful there at all. I think since Sunday school, for most of us, maybe it was since Vacation Bible School, we've heard the stories about Jesus. We've heard the stories of Jesus calming the seas. We heard that just a few weeks ago here in worship, as a matter of fact. In fact, we've heard Jesus about feeding the multitudes with only a few loaves and fishes. He fed thousands of people. We've heard the stories of Jesus driving out the demons and healing the sick. We've heard the stories of Jesus sitting with the afflicted, with the outcast, with the poor of society. We've heard all these stories about Jesus all of our lives that are giving us glimpses into what we really believe the kingdom of God should be about and giving us a direction for our lives to follow that way and that truth and that life of Jesus Christ. But in Nazareth, in his own hometown, Jesus seems to have had his power neutralized. He couldn't do any miracles there. It says right there in the gospel. This is the only time that's recorded where Jesus doesn't have power to do certain types of things like his miracles. The rejection that Jesus experienced through the contempt of his hometown neighbors had to have been dramatic for him. It was a dramatic point in his ministry. And I think as we read this story, and I'm sure most of you are familiar with this story, you've heard it before. You know, what do we do today here in the 21st century? What do Christians do? We sort of look down on the people of Nazareth, don't we? For responding the way they did to Jesus. We sort of look down our noses, you know. But if that's all we do in this passage, I think we miss a very important point. Because I think we need to remember that our lives are also marked by disbelief. And our lives are often marked by just maybe subtle rejections of Jesus as well. I think we too often limit what we think God is capable of doing in our lives, just as the people of Nazareth did with Jesus coming back into their lives. So I think Mark's gospel lesson challenges us to consider, well, how is it that we in our lives inhibit God's work? What is it that we do to inhibit what God could do with us in our lives here in our own church, in our own community, around this world? You know, we were called in our baptism. We were called to serve Jesus. We were called to spread the kingdom of God. But you know, oftentimes there are factors that sort of neutralize us in that call, that stop us from doing what we've been called to do as Christians. Often we have regrets that we can't overcome in our lives. We have grudges that we just will not surrender. We're just going to hold on to them. We have addictions that come into our lives that greatly disrupt what's happening. We have angers or hurts that blind our vision of what God has in mind for us. And in this most familiar quotation from this passage, Mark gives us a reason why we're often unable to function fully as committed followers of Jesus Christ. And it says, prophets are not without honor, except in their own hometown and among their own kin and in their own house. And I really believe that that's true in what you look at throughout history. The hardest place for us to share our faith sometimes is in our own homes, among our own family members, in our own house, if you will. Among those people who know us best, sometimes it's most difficult to share our faith. And he goes on to say he could do no deeds of power there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them, which is considered to be a lot of power. But anyway, that's what it says in the passage. And I think this is what John, the prophet John, had in mind when he wrote in John 1. He came to his own people, and his own people received him not. From the first chapter of John. Yeah, this is an intriguing story. The story we have in the Gospel of Mark. As long as we relegate it to that time and place over 2,000 years ago, that little town of Nazareth, halfway across the world, 2,000 years ago, if we put it over there and think of it in that way, then we're comfortable in judging those silly Nazarenes. How can they have been contemptuous of Jesus Christ? But the problem is, we often are the people of Nazareth. We are the Nazarenes who reject Jesus Christ, who reject his message, who reject his power too often in our lives. Because we in the church, you know, we are the people that have known Jesus all our lives. I don't know about you, but my parents took me to Sunday school when I was a little bitty kid. You know, I was like Harper back there, running up and down the aisles. And I think that's true of lots of us. And even if you didn't get to go when you were 1 year old, I know, looking around here, that you've been going for many years, because I've been here 5 years, and I see almost everybody's been here a lot longer than me. Coming to church. We're the ones that know Jesus so well. We look at him every Sunday morning. He's right there. There he is. We're here. We know Jesus. We hear these stories. We know Jesus best. We watch Jesus grow up through the Gospels. From that little tiny baby that we celebrate on Christmas morning, all the way to that man who suffered and died, was crucified, and then resurrected on Easter morning. You know the story. We know the life of Jesus. We know who he is. We know what he was. We have pictures of him all over the church. We even have a statue of his mom and dad that we use on Christmas time, that we set out in front of the church. Jesus is extremely familiar to all of us. And our gospel lesson here in Mark reminds us that the community of faith is sometimes the hardest place for the good news of Jesus to be heard. The disciples in this story, they had great success. In all of the surrounding villages, they had great success in telling the gospel story. But not in Nazareth. Not in the place where the people were the most familiar with Jesus Christ. Looking back over my life as a Christian, most of you know I've been a member of several different churches in my life and associated with different denominations, beginning with the Assembly of God, then the Disciples of Christ, then the Methodists, and finally the Presbyterians took, I guess, because that's sort of where I've settled for the last many years. Looking back over my life and all the church people that I've been associated in my life, one of the fears that I have as a pastor today is that many churches and many different denominations, rather than inculcating faith in the lives of those we touch, Far too often, churches immunize people against the radical demands of the gospel. Jesus was pretty radical. He was pretty radical in what he said and in what he did. In the church, sometimes we push that aside. And sometimes Jesus becomes so familiar that he's just like a good-natured brother to us, you know? And we're familiar with him in that capacity, and it's so comfortable to be here in this place. And so, you know what happens? We see over and over and over again in my lifetime members of the traditional churches drifting away toward the latest spiritual craze that they've seen on TV or that they see ads for and displayed on the internet today. You know, when people are trying all these other things. So sometimes we have to admit that we are the people of Nazareth. We take Jesus and his message for granted. We don't realize how radical it is and what it should speak to us in our lives, how it should speak to us in our lives. There are other ways that we become people of Nazareth as well. One of the ways is that we sometimes narrow our understanding of what it means to be a Christian. Jesus came proclaiming a gospel of love and of acceptance. I don't think there's any way you can look at the Bible and deny that. His gospel centered on love and acceptance of other people and towards other people. And yet, have you noticed in your lifetimes, as I've noticed in mine, that sometimes Christian people are among the most intolerant, the most judgmental, the most prejudicial of all people? Sometimes it's hard for us as Christians people to realize that, to see that, to recognize that, and I find that amazing. Some of you know that when I was in seminary, I did some work in a church in Washington, Missouri. I was hoping Alan Doors would be here today. Their family's been around. We should have said a prayer for them. Please do that. They were actually in Washington, Missouri, Alan Doris Judy, when I was working in that church in seminary there. It was not a Presbyterian church. It was a UCC church. It's the largest Protestant church in the town of Washington, Missouri, St. Peter's UCC. Very nice church. Has a membership of over 1,000 people. Very active church. A lot of the things I did there when I was in seminary was not only preached occasionally, they had 2 full-time pastors there, so I didn't get to preach that much. Until the second 6 months I was there, their associate pastor went on maternity leave for 3 months, and they hired me half-time to sort of fill in her shoes, which was difficult to do because she was very good. One of the things that I did in filling in for her is I worked with their confirmation group. And they had like 20 middle school kids in their confirmation group. And I did a lot of things with that particular group, things like I've done with confirmation groups here as well. But one of the things that I did that just struck me, and I remember it every time I read this passage and think about it, is that at one point I asked these confirmation kids, there were, like I said, about 20 of them, mixed group, guys and gals. I asked them, you know, how would you contrast the people you know in the church with the people that don't go to church? The people that, you know, you never see in church, that you know in town, you know them. You know, what's the difference between people that go to church and the people that don't go to church? And the overwhelming answer I received from those kids was the people that didn't go to church are nicer. They don't talk about other people. People in the church are talking about these other people and what they should be doing and shouldn't be doing. But the other people, they're not talking about. They said the people that don't go to church are nicer. And my, that was a difficult issue to try to deal with 20 middle school kids, you know, because they're dealing with issues of good and bad and nice and not nice and black and white things all the time in their lives. And but that really struck me, that they said, well, the biggest difference was people that aren't in church are nicer. They don't talk about the other people like the people in church do. And I'm always amazed at how hard Christian people, certain Christian groups, will work to cull out from the scripture individual passages that give you some kind of justification to shame or to blame or to humiliate
other people.
Rather than work for the welfare of all, many well-meaning church people, and I mean they are very well-meaning church people, but they end up isolating specific Bible passages, and they use them to condemn specific groups of people, defining people in the most narrow manner. How would you like your entire life to be defined in one very narrow way? You know, hey, you have gray hair. That defines who you are. And so I'm going to classify you and say, you feel this way and act this way and do this way. You know, that doesn't make up who we are. One defining characteristic that we have. You all know lots of Christian groups that have done that. If we define people in one narrow manner, I think that certainly overlooks the significant biblical tradition that calls on us to stand in solidarity with all God's children. To stand in solidarity with the poor, with the widow, with the orphan, even with the foreigner. For far too long, shame and guilt have been encoded into too many church traditions. And often that's encouraged by our theology. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And that's a part of our theology. But more often than that, it's not the church theology or the church teachings, but it's our belief about what being a pious Christian is all about that causes us to see many people as not measuring up to some preconceived Christian standard, some preconceived notions of what we as Christians should look like or what we as Christians should act like. And since we're not perfect, as Christ was perfect, well, we should be ashamed, you know, because we're not perfect. We're not acting, you know, we're not always following the best way, the best truth, and the best life. So shame on us. You know, we're poor sinners. We're not going to be perfect. And that shaming attitude that the church often has tells Christians we should do better. We should do a lot better than what we're doing right now. Have you ever felt that way in church? Man, I should be doing better. Did you hear what he said? You know, shame on me. Shame on me. I should be doing better. I should be a better Christian. I hope you haven't had too much of an association with a church that tells you that all the time and tries to beat you over the head with that. But you know, there was a study conducted by the Alden Institute that indicated that 1 in 3 Protestant denominations in the United States, 1 in 3, that means a third, 33% of all the Protestant denominations in the United States has serious issues of shame. And they try to shame their people, and it impacts the life of the congregation. And shame is loosely defined in their study that they did as a feeling of unworthiness in the sight of God. Unworthiness in the sight of God. I hope you feel that you are a beautiful part of God's creation. You're not unworthy in the sight of God, but God cares for you. And I think we have to be so careful in the church not to emphasize that being poor sinners and being unworthy in God's eyes. We are not unworthy in God's eyes. God loves us and God cares for us. The church should have a message of unconditional love and acceptance. But often what some churches proclaim is a message that condemns sinful behavior and reminds us of the manifold ways in which we all fall short. That's not what Jesus said. Jesus didn't preach that there were so many ways that we fall short. But once we start hearing that kind of message over and over again, it's so easy for people to hear not just that they made a mistake, but to hear, I am a mistake. You know, I'm never going to be able to measure up. I'm never going to be worthy of God's love. That's true. 1/3 of the churches have that issue in Protestant denominations today. Is it any wonder that so many people are abandoning the church? not wanting to come to a place that tells them they should be ashamed? In her book, Leaving Church, one of my favorite authors, Barbara Brown Taylor, speaks of her longing for being near to God. I mean, that was a lifelong passion of hers, to try to be near to God. And she thought for most of her life that the way to achieve that was to work as hard as she could in the church on behalf of the church. And so she did just that. She tried to never say no to anybody that wanted her to do anything within the church. And so, of course, she was ignoring her own needs because she could never say, I can't do that right now. And that was the entire pattern of her ministry, to work as hard as she possibly could, to never say no to anything or to anybody within the church, until she discovered, hey, that's just really not working for me. You know, I'm not getting any closer to God doing this. And that's what I want. That's what I want to strive for, is a nearness to God. And it was only when she was able to accept God's unconditional love. Did you hear that? Unconditional love. It's not conditional on what we do. It's not conditional on our actions. God loves us unconditionally. And Barbara Brown Taylor said once she could accept that, then she started to achieve a more personal wholeness in her life. She discovered the reality of being at peace with God made her so much more useful to the kingdom of God. And she was so much more effective in her ministry and in her life. And she was happy in her life, just simply by accepting God's unconditional love for her. Made her so much more useful than trying to be some kind of superstar Christian that you might have up there to do everything and to be everything and to never say no to anybody. Barbara Brown Taylor, if you've never read any of her works, there's lots that I could recommend that you might want to read of hers. My message this morning is just to emphasize that we need to strive to be a people who not only hear the message of Jesus Christ, but to live that message as well. Let us not be like those Nazarenes. Let us not be like the people of Nazareth in Jesus' day, who became so familiar with Jesus that they just had contempt for him. And they really didn't believe that he had any true power in their lives. You know, we need to feel greatly blessed, because we are greatly blessed that we're in a church and that we've heard the stories of Jesus, that we know the gospel message. We're blessed by that. Those things affirm our lives, who we are as a Christian, as a people of God. We should feel fortunate to be so richly blessed with these stories and with these rituals. So I'm not telling you don't go to church. I hope you continue to come to church and you continue to be blessed by these stories and by the gospel message. We've been given a special promise. We were given a special promise in our baptism. We're given a special promise every time we approach the Lord's table in communion. So don't let us be Nazareth people. We don't want to be Nazarene. We don't want to have contempt for Jesus Christ. Rather, we need to be Jesus' disciples who will readily share the good news of God's love with one another and with others. So we need to join together with the holy gathering of witnesses that have been a part of this church, that have been a part of this ministry right here at First Presbyterian Church since 1902. We need to gather with those and share the good news of God's love. That's how we live the way, the truth, and the life. Sharing the good news of God's love. So let us continue to join with this holy gathering of witnesses that have come before us, that are still here with us today, and live into the good news that our Lord really came to proclaim, especially right here in our own church. Thanks be to God. Okay. Let us now respond to our word this morning by rising together, either in body or in spirit, and singing together our hymn of response. which is Spirit of God, descend upon my heart, found on page 390 in your book. So then rise together. Thanks. Join with me now in the affirmation of faith you might find printed in your bulletin this morning, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in
God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into heaven. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We now come to that point in our service where we have an opportunity to give of the many blessings that we have received in our lives. So as our ushers come forward and we hear our special music this morning, please be generous in your gifts.
Thank you.
just as you have blessed this country, we ask now that you bless these tokens that we bring before you, so that your love, that your message, that your power, that your glory may be spread not just throughout this country, but throughout this entire world, that your message may be heard and people may come to your way. We ask all these things in your precious name. Amen. You may be seated. Let us now pause for a moment of silence as we prepare our hearts and minds for prayer. Gracious and all-giving God, as we find ourselves in this season of patriotism and love of country, remind us of the true power deserving of our praise in this world. You are God. We give you all the glory and honor this day, our God, and we thank you for blessing us to be able to live and prosper in the United States of America. Even in the midst of all the joyous celebrations and displays of fireworks and our enjoyment of good friends and family and good food, we are still mindful that there are those who cannot celebrate at this time. We know, our God, that there are those who are sick and hurting. There are those who are lonely and depressed. We know there are those who are thirsty and hungry, those who are tired and ill at ease. For all of those who are in need this day, we ask a special prayer that they may receive some measure of your hospitality and love today, on this day, July 8th. Use us, our God, as instruments of your love to be the vessels to convey your hospitality to our brothers and sisters in our community and around our world. May it be so. And now, be with us as we repeat the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us now rise one last time, either in body or in spirit, and sing together our closing hymn. And open my eyes that I may see, found on page 563. Shall we rise together? Thank you. school will be going on here at church. If you don't have an active role in being here physically and assisting in Bible school, please keep all the workers and all the children that will be here in your prayers this week, as they certainly will need your prayers. So your assist in Bible school is definitely needed. So keep us in mind, keep everyone in mind that will be here for Bible school all week long. I don't know if we mentioned the group is going to the Oars this Friday night as well. So I think everybody knows you had to sign up for that in advance. So that will be taking place. Let's keep that group in mind this Friday evening as well, as a group of our church members will be attending the Kim Massey concert. The float trip then will be next week, and it's summertime, and lots of summertime activities are taking place all around. So I hope you are able to get out and enjoy the summertime and the summer weather, and to just enjoy God's great creation in any way that you can. Regardless of what you're doing, regardless of where you are this week and any day, remember that God is always there with you. Because God is always above us to bless us. God is always below us to support us. God is always behind us to protect us. God always goes before us to guide us. God always stands right beside us to comfort us. And most importantly of all, God is inside of us to bring us joy and peace. So go in peace this day, my friends. Amen.